Welcome to the Shipping Podcast, where you meet interesting maritime professionals sharing their passion for the shipping industry and their everyday job. I am your host. My name is Lena Gothberg. Welcome on board. I'm so happy that you're joining me on this journey. Today I will introduce you to one of the younger ship owners in Sweden, Mr. David Christensen. Within the shipping industry, ship owners come in all shape and forms. The most famous shipping lines probably started as a small company, usually by someone very passionate about shipping who's been sailing themselves. David Christensen is the fifth generation ship owner from a small island outside Gothenburg. He is 37 years old, married, and the father of two. He represents the new generation of ship owners, both since he is young, but also because he is developing a new segment of vessels, namely crew transfer vessels, multipurpose high-speed catamarans designed for transport of crew to offshore wind farms. I think it's important to sometimes be reminded of the fact that many ship owners are small, family-owned companies earning their living from their ships. It's not all large companies with huge turnovers. I went to the office of the Northern Offshore Services and met David Friday afternoon on June the 5th, just after we both had been to the Nor-Shipping in Oslo. He showed me all the changes they had made since my last visit. More employees, more desks, to fill up the rooms of this beautiful building, which originally was a bathhouse erected in 1908, carefully renovated by Northern Offshore, including the jetty outside, where you from time to time can see some of their vessels anchored for a very short while. So, all aboard! Let's go and meet David Christensen. David Christensen, welcome to the podcast. Who are you?
Thank you for welcoming me. I am an entrepreneur in the shipping industry. It's how I see myself. We try to build up a new niche in shipping, and today we're working in offshore wind with small high-speed catamarans that transfer personnel and equipment to the wind turbines offshore.
So how did you start in shipping?
I'm raised in shipping, I would say. I'm coming from a small island outside the west coast of Sweden, outside Gothenburg, called Donsö. It's a well-known island in the shipping industry, and my family has been in this cluster for over 100 years. My ancestors started already in 1904, and before that we were, smugglers or almost pirates out on the islands. But in the modern history, then we have been involved in the tanker business with chemical tankers and product tankers and bunkering vessels and so on. So my interest has always been vessels and shipping. And that's maybe my only interest.
Did you take any education sort of connected to shipping, or are you an engineer, or how did you?
When I was younger, I was aware that I wanted to work in the industry somehow, but I didn't know maybe exactly where. Of course, drive boats and also later vessels. So in my later studies, I went to the university and studied to master mariner. So today I have a bachelor there in science for to be a master.
So how come the idea of wind and offshore? That's a new niche here in Sweden, at least.
Yeah, when I began on board, it was in the most on tankers and bunker barges. That is quite common on Donsö, and that was what I thought I should do in my rest of my life. But then I had a friend from my childhood that wanted to start something new, and he constructed a boat in a small high-speed catamaran in the UK, There, me actually and my brother assisted him to finalize the project. And when that project was finished, then he got a requirement or a request from a big dredging company, Van Oord, a Dutch company. And they asked him if he could come to Holland and work for in one of the new offshore wind parks that was constructed. This was 2007, I think. And that was the beginning of everything. We was quite happy because we had the commitment for the vessel, and we did a very good job because we had done an innovative product. It was a catamaran that has a special propulsion system, and that did the vessel extremely efficient. So we did two vessels work with our vessel. So the client was happy. We didn't know that then, but we thought we earned good money. But they was even happier because they earn even more.
Oh, I see. Well, there is only one way to learn, isn't there?
Yeah.
So was Northern Offshore Services started in 2007 then, or when?
This was because the boat was actually not built for offshore wind. It was built for that we should do crew transfer and equipment transfer to the vessel's merchant fleet in the west coast of Sweden. So that was our aim. But when we come into this, then we saw that we are entering a new niche market that could be interesting and to be developed for persons like us that are raised in vessel maneuvering and so on, and that was not and you were not needed to buy a tanker vessel for hundreds of millions or anything, so you could start in a smaller way, and therefore we saw that here maybe we could fit in and start a new niche. So actually we started our company Northern Offshore Services in beginning of 2008, and there our first customer or client was Siemens Wind Power, and he actually the procurement there said that I personally have nothing to gain to test your company, because it's better that I take the supplier we have, because I will not gain so much if it's going better, but if it's going worse, then maybe my job is loose. So, but he tried us anyway, and we could prove in ourselves that we was more efficient than the colleagues or competitors, and therefore, we managed to secure the contract and did a good job.
Yeah, I understand that you took your shipping knowledge into the wind area instead of the other way around. I think you've told me that once.
Yeah, I think the way why we have succeeded as we have done is the competence we have, the core competence regarding operating vessels, and also the interest that we have. So we know, or we think we at least know how to operate a vessel in a good and efficient way. And in our industry, it's very much up to the personnel on board, because it's small vessels that have small crews, and it's in high speed, so therefore you need to react quick, and the guys on board needs to be professional and could handle the most things. And in our cluster where we come from, there are a lot of persons that have been also raised in the shipping industry. So that is one of our advantages, I would say.
So you started with one vessel in 2008, and how many vessels do you own today?
Yeah, today, 7 years later, we operate 19, and we have three more under construction. And now we're also entering more customized and innovative segments. So now the wind is our core business, but today also now we have won a contract that we build a new ambulance vessel with, and there we do the whole concept with the cars, ambulance cars, vessel, nurses, crew, the marine crew, and then we should combine this to a concept that could operate offshore and to the archipelago here in west of Sweden. And we have a contract with I think it's Northern Europe's biggest hospital, Sahlgrenska University Hospital, and that of course we are very proud of, and we are the only private company that has been awarded also the ambulance service. So otherwise it's only governmental owned.
I also know that you are the only private company that is sort of taking care of the pilots.
Yeah, we did here in Sweden had a lot for several years we operated a pilot station with the boats. We did not have the pilots, but we have the boatmans and handling the vessels and the service. And we thought maybe this could be a niche also, and it was therefore we started. But here in Sweden, it's taking a long time, and there has not been commercialized. It's still under the government control, and therefore we actually let it go now the last year. So because we saw it was too small for us, we wanted to be able to grow if we should keep it.
I see. And also you told me about a research vessel.
Yeah. We see that maybe there are a place for us as a company that that's are innovative, that could take care of vessels and other things that maybe traditional shipping companies do not want to handle. And now we have also been awarded a contract from Gothenburg University. They are building a new research vessel, a 50-meter vessel that shall operate here in Northern Europe. And we have been awarded the ship management contract, both technical and commercially. And that is, of course, exciting for us. And now we're entering in a new, one more new market. There we think it could be, a lot of development to do.
You are a true entrepreneur. It's amazing to see that you see business opportunities wherever.
Yeah, I don't think we have. I've seen myself as that in the beginning, because that was our. Then the aim was to operate boats or vessels, but in the past years we have seen that maybe you need to be some kind of entrepreneur, or you have to see. You cannot just focus in one thing. You need to find new ways, and especially today when everything goes so fast, so it's even more important to be on your toes, we try our best.
And it's also a family company.
Yeah,
you have a lot of family members working here.
Today our company group is three companies. One that's operating vessels and for the wind industry, and also these customized solutions. And then we have also one company that do the ship supply service. And what I mean with that is that we do the logistic service for on the waterways here in West Coast Gothenburg or in Denmark. There we supply crew change and stores, etc. And then we have also a third company that's our energy company that sells marine fuels, and they also are the distributor of ExxonMobil lubricants here in Sweden, and also for the offshore market in Northern Europe.
And that is where your sister and your wife is working.
Yeah, so actually it's my sister and my wife, and also my brother. And my father is working in the company, so yes, of course, it's a family company.
And your mother-in-law?
Yeah, both my mother-in-law and my father-in-law, actually, and also my wife's brothers. They're also master mariners, so they are masters in some of our vessels. So yeah, it's...
So how many people do you employ now?
In the group, I think we are maybe 150, 180 people, something like that.
So it's not all related people.
No, no. Not all of them. Fortunately, it's not. So, but a lot of them are, and we come from a small community. So of course, you know a lot of the employees. Of course, today. Now we are spread over both Sweden and Denmark, and we have a few from other countries as well. So now it's another issue, of course. But yeah, in the beginning, it was a lot of friends and relatives that was employed, yes.
Yeah. How do you find it to recruit new people? I mean, especially seagoing personnel.
We have been quite fortunate there because we have offices in two countries, in Denmark and in Sweden, and therefore we have been able to recruit from two core markets, and that has been an advantage for us because we could pick up good persons from two different countries, and in the past years now we have seen that our reputation grew stronger, and therefore a lot of persons want to work for us now. So actually, the personnel situation today is very good for us. We have persons, crew persons that waiting and want to be employed, but unfortunately we cannot employ them all for the moment.
Okay, so that's a good position to be in a way. How do you see the future for the shipping industry in general?
It's hard for me to say anything. I can just look at my micro perspective, but what we can see is everything goes faster and faster, and you need to react quicker, and the shipping trade is increasing, that we know. Maybe sometimes in some branches it's going up and down, but it's always do. But in the long run, I think we in the shipping will be one of the winners, because it's hard to take away all the marine trade and the logistic. It's a wheel, it's a big wheel in the world economy. So if you just can be in this industry and do smart solutions, I think you will make well in the life to come, because I cannot see that it will be something that will be replace this industry in not in the near future in a way.
No, I agree with you. I just wanted to hear it from you. So sometimes the shipping industry is called the invisible industry. No one knows about us. We are so secret to the public.
I think maybe, it could be true here in Sweden, it is, yes. But if you come to our neighbors in Scandinavia, as Denmark and Norway, I will say it's not, especially in these two countries. I think what's make different there is if everybody has some relations to shipping, somebody working in it, and that you can also see on the governmental level, because every person's inside there also have some relatives or some relations, and that also makes a big and huge difference. But of course, and that is what we can see here from my micro perspective. How it's far out in the world, I cannot really say, but in Scandinavia it's a big difference in just neighbor countries, and that's maybe both good and bad. But me as a Swede is of course sad that we are not a stronger industry in our own country. That's of course.
Do you have any ideas of how we could become more visible? How could more people know about the industry, and how can we recruit the next generation if they don't know that we are there?
I think we have been quite traditional, and that has been a problem. We have done as we always have done, and we need to be more commercialized in the official way. And our branch organizations needs also to step up. And I will say that I think the Ship Owners Association has done this now the last years here in Sweden, and that makes a difference. We have a very good CEO in the organization today, and she is doing a tremendous work, I will say. But everybody must help, and you need to profile the innovative and the exciting things in the industry, as all the other industries does. Of course, and I think there are good things to show, but you need to think outside the box. But as I say, here in our company, we don't have any box. We always are outside it. But I think it's the same for all industries. But of course, the bigger industry you are, desto more visible you will be and are.
Yeah, I think you're right. We just came back from the Nor-Shipping conference, you and I, where you were nominated for the Young Entrepreneur of the Year. However, someone else won. We don't speak too much about that. But how did you find the Nor-Shipping?
It's a very exciting when we set on the nominee ceremony. It was impressive to see that the king and also the prime minister and also the other ministers was there, and the prime minister also held a welcoming speech and talked about how important the industry are, the shipping industry are. That was amazing for me as a Swede to hear, and it gave me more power, I believe, to do more things. And that was really, really nice, and see how they react and how important they think the industry are. And in Norway, they have been extremely innovative with new vessels, and the industry is extremely, I would say, impressive. So this is always a boost to come and see what they are doing, and if we can do a little bit at the same way, we will come a long way, I will believe. It's an energy kick.
Yeah, I agree. And I was proud to be a Swede because there were at least two projects, if we call you a project, nominated among all these others. Two Swedish ones, and both from Donsu, actually.
Yeah, that's of course, we as local patriots, it's of course very honorable that we had been nominated. It was extremely grateful for that. Unfortunately, none of us won, but we are young, so maybe we can come back again. We will see.
Yeah, I agree with you. You are also on the fellowship of Prince Daniel.
Yes.
How did that come around?
It was actually our prince is involved in entrepreneurship, and he wants to assist and to see if we can grow these entrepreneurs in Sweden. We have a low percentage compared to other countries, and therefore he is burning a lot for this. And he has started Prince Daniel's fellowship that should be able to assist young entrepreneurs that could have companies that could be as mid-size or bigger companies. And I was chosen thanks to I will say our bank, actually Nordea was awarding me, and some other, and thanks to that I was also chosen as one of the five front runners, because we are the first year now. So and we have done this project for 2 years, and now I think it will be growing and be bigger and bigger. But what is extremely cool is that he have gathered the Sweden's top company leaders and entrepreneurs, and that will be able to do a mentorship also. So I was had the fortune to be awarded one of our industry profiles here in Sweden, Mr. Carl Bennett. And of course, that has given me a lot of open doors and good advices, and that we can really see that it works, that his fellowship works, and if he can scale this up, it will be good for the country, I will believe.
It's so interesting. You have been awarded and nominated for a lot of awards lately, so who knows where that will end up at the end of the day. Thank you for your time. Who do you think I should speak to the next time on my podcast? Have you got any ideas? Who would you be interested to listen to yourself?
Well, it's a good good question. But I think it could be very interesting to hear one of the industry entrepreneurs also, and they could see that has maybe a relation to the shipping industry and how they see the shipping industry. So you can hear from somebody that has other eyes on our industry. That should be interesting.
Okay. Any specific?
Yeah, we have some big companies here in Sweden that use a lot of shipping services, and maybe one of these executives from that companies could be very interested. Yeah.
So I got a new task then, a new goal to try and get that. Thank you very much, David, for your time, and hope to see you soon again.
Thank you, Lena.
As you probably noticed, David is a very humble person with the characteristics of a true entrepreneur. Lots of ideas flying around, always looking for new business. He's also a product of growing up on an island. He knows the importance of tradition and of networking. Maybe this is why the vision for the Northern Offshore Services is best 365, to be best at what they do every day. Apparently their ambition to always do their best have paid off, since David has been awarded several times lately. He became Shipping Profile of the Year in Sweden in 2013, and he was nominated as Young Shipping Entrepreneur of the Year at New Shipping earlier this year. I hope you got inspired by David and his endeavor to become a shipping mogul. I certainly am. Speaking of which, I want to become a podcast mogul, and I hope you want to help me achieve that. Please spread the word about the shipping podcast. Tell everyone who doesn't know the first thing about shipping and make them realize what a cool industry we are working in. And since you have managed to listen to this episode of the shipping podcast, tell your shipping friends who still hasn't understood how to start. I get a lot of interesting answers to my new standard question. Have you listened to my podcast? Most people answer, well, I haven't had the time to listen yet. Okay, maybe you should see this as a part of your job. There are so many things you can do whilst listening to the maritime professionals. When I continue to ask why people haven't listened yet, I understand that there are many people who doesn't really know how to get the podcast. So this is an area where you can help me. They need some hands-on instructions, so please show them on their mobiles. Help them to start their new adventure in cyberspace. They will be grateful in the future. So, until the next time, I got a new interesting interview piled up for you. See you soon. Bye-bye.